Hey guys, today I want to talk about some more safety stuff. We're going to talk about inflatable vests or air vests in the equestrian world. The first thing that you need to know, well, I guess the first thing is to determine what type of protection safety gear you want to wear. You have your helmet, but we're talking about body protection. So for body protection, your only real choices are inflatables or foam vests. If you go into the other sports like, skiing, motocross, stuff like that, some people do use motocross gear or dirt biking gear, that type of armor, and incorporate it, you use it for their horseback riding as well, and that's totally an option. Something like motocross and stuff, they do have these long sleeve shirts with armor built in, and so, you know, that is something that will protect your arms as well as everything else, and it moves with you because it is a shirt. It just has extra armor and stuff built into it, so those are options. But a lot of times I hear people, you know, ask about, well, should I get a foam vest or should I get an inflatable vest? A foam vest, this is not your typical foam vest. This is a Cantech foam. And you can see that, you know, the foam is very thick. It is very hard. I can't depress and push and compress this armor on my own. The advantage, well, first off, I don't think that you can compare foam to an inflatable. That's like comparing apples to oranges. And when you try to choose between those two, then it's basically like saying, should I get a car that has airbags or seatbelts? So the answer is they both. You know, you should have one with as much protection as possible, and you shouldn't be choosing between the two, especially when the way that they work is completely different from each other. So as you can see with the foam vest, it's always gonna be on you. As long as you're wearing it, it's gonna be on. As long as it fits right, it's gonna be there and protecting you no matter what. You don't have to be riding. You have protection even when you're on the ground. A lot of the equine professionals like vets and, you know, equine vets and whatever, they're starting to want to wear helmets and some kind of body armor when they're working around horses because they can get kicked, smushed, squished, whatever, as well. So this is something that is going to always be there and it's going to protect. The difference is that an inflatable is only protective if it deploys, and for a second or so when it's at its maximum in inflated state, from maximum to maybe, I don't know, 75-80%, in that zone, that's when it's at its maximum protective state. As it deflates, and the moment it is deployed, it inflates, and then it immediately starts deflating again because they all have compulsory bleed valves. And so it starts to deflate immediately, and it'll deflate anywhere from 3 to 10 seconds, I've heard. And it's probably dependent on if there's a big weight push. So if the horse is on top of you, helping it deflate faster, or whatever. So if you figure you got 3 to 10 seconds, and then you cut that in half and say, okay, so in half, let's say 6 seconds as a middle number, then say 50% deflation. How protective would that be? Okay, 75 deflation, how protective is that? It's probably still pretty protective. 50%, it's halfway empty already. How protective is that? Then 30% or 10%, 5%, and then zero when it's just a bag again, right? So an inflatable vest is basically a bag in a vest form that you wear. It inflates with air. As it deflates and all that, it's giving you protection, but then as soon as it's back down to just a thin little bag, it's not really protecting you any longer. Now, point two will say, well, they've studied, countless equine crashes, and you only need protection for, or they say the accident is over within half a second. Well, that's fine and good if you want to talk about the majority and stuff, but I can give you other examples where the accident was over in 11 seconds or 4 seconds and stuff like that. You know, if you're both caught up in the ditch. Another thing I realize as I'm studying all of these is when a horse first falls down, they're completely down on the ground. Sometimes it takes them a second. They'll be laying there, and then it takes them a second or so, and then they scramble to get up. Well, if you and the horse are down on the ground, so there's your first impact, and then the horse is laying there, and you're like, okay, ho, 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 and then, you know, a few seconds later, the horse decides, I want up, I'm gonna get up, and then boom, boom, boom. So in that time, if you're only wearing an inflatable vest, it's, you know, it has already deflated and all that, or whatever. So the thing is, there's so many infinite possibilities and stuff. I can give you examples on how the inflatable will not protect. And then it's like, okay, do you really want to take your chances? And that decision is totally up to you. One of the biggest reasons why inflatable vests are so popular, way more popular than a foam, is because these are bulky and heavy and restrict you, and they're hot and all that. Now you can see this one only covers to here. While I mentioned that, I will say one of the benefits to an inflatable is that inflatable will cover where the foam doesn't cover. They'll give you neck protection. They'll give you even more protection. Also, this is a beta level 3 protector. Okay, so a lot of people will say beta level 3 is the highest level protection you can get. And then people think, oh, that means 100% protection. And it's not. The highest level, beta level 3, is still only gonna reduce the chances of a broken bone by a certain percentage. And of course, you know, all the factors that go into it are infinite. But this is not a guarantee that I won't get broken ribs. It's just going to dramatically decrease the amount of shock that is allowed into my system. So with if I wear this and an inflatable over it, reduce the amount of shock that enters my body even more. And even with this, the ultimate protection, okay, and you can't argue this, no one can argue this, the ultimate protection is to have a beta level 3 foam vest that fits you correctly and all that, and an inflatable vest that works well, that deployed over it. That is the highest form of protection. Any choosing one or the other is going to be significantly less than together. The foam is just that it's always there, and the inflatable, you have to then take into consideration when it won't deploy. So when will an inflatable not deploy? Well, it's attached by a lanyard to your saddle by a springy lanyard thingy, right? So it's attached. So basically, if you separate from the saddle, some people, the one of the biggest concerns people have is, oh, I'm gonna forget to detach the lanyard and I'm gonna get off and then it's gonna deploy. That has happened, but more likely, you are able to slide off and it won't deploy because it needs a large yank. This does have a bit of a stretch, so especially if your horse isn't too tall and stuff like that. On Lacer, it probably would deploy even if I just really gently dismounted. Now you know, they also talk about the length of the lanyard. It has to be specific. You don't want it to be too long that you can drop to the ground and have it not deploy. But you also don't want it to be too short that any little thing and then it's going to deploy. So the length of the lanyard and stuff, you have to be careful about how you care for your canister and your vest and how you put it on, how you screw it on. They have the way that they do it is supposed to be dummy proof, but just know that if it's not done correctly, then that can lead to a malfunction. And then there is the X factor of malfunctions. There are parts to this, so it can malfunction, and there have been actual cases where it doesn't deploy when it should have deployed. And then the one that I know of happened to be a hit air vest, and the lady sent it back to hit air, and they said, yeah, it was just a malfunction. It's very, very rare that this happens, but it does happen. I have a huge problem with that, because what if that was the one crash that does you in, or that one crash that makes you paralyzed, and the one thing that you were counting on was that inflatable vest to deploy, and it didn't deploy, not for any fault of your own or anything, it was just that it just didn't deploy. And you know, to put all your eggs into that basket and have it completely fail on you, that's a huge, you know, I can't deal with that. So that is why if I was to have one vest, it would be a foam vest, because I know that that's going to be there. But once again, ultimate protection is to have both. Now, reason why people is so popular to choose just an inflatable vest is because it's cooler. You know, it's just a very simple vest that you put on. It's basically just one little layer, one extra layer vest, right, that you put on. It's very airy. You can put it on over any of your clothes. It doesn't have to be, you know, custom fitted, unlike a foam vest that needs to be fit just right to work. You know, you don't need to have the custom fitting and stuff like that. You can just put it on. It's so much cooler and lighter than a foam vest. So that's why that they are so popular. But that is also dependent on where you come from. Most equestrians come from a place where they're not used to any kind of body protection at all. So to them, any little addition to their regular wear, like a tank top or whatever, is going to be a big deal. So for someone who's never worn any kind of protection, this is a big deal. This is bulky and hot and oh my gosh, this is so much to wear and stuff. And I hear you. Before I bought this, you know, I was right there. But I have the advantage of coming from motorcycle racing, and I wore full leathers. So this is armored here. It's got armor in the shoulder and the elbow and the forearm, and armor in the hips, and it is padded all throughout, and it's really thick leather. And the protection goes all, I mean, this is full body protection. These are just knee sliders. That's just where you drag knee. That's not armor. But see, all of this. So if you want to talk about bulky and heavy, this is bulky and heavy and hot. So because I come from this and I'm used to that mentality and my body is used to wearing something like that, then the Cantec vest is not as big a deal for me. But even so, I still had to go through that whole transition in my head to go, okay, what are your priorities? Do you want to be cooler, or do you want to greatly reduce the chance of paralysis and death and whatever? Okay, so those were the hard things that I had to deal with. And you know, these vests are really expensive. These, you know, our protective gear is really expensive. Their good ones are usually in the 500 range and up. But when I got my last hospital bill from the crash, it was a $48,000 hospital bill. All they did was diagnostics, not even any treatment. I didn't even get an Advil out of it, right? It was just go in and x-rays, MRIs, blood work, and CAT scan. And so it was just those things, but those things all cost a lot of money. Plus the ER visit itself was like $5,000. My the amount that I owed was just $2,000. That was my deductible. But you figured $500 for a vest or $2,000 and the pain and all that of your injuries, permanent injury going on for the rest of my life sort of thing. So that's the deal about cost. Now, the cost between a foam and an inflatable. The inflatable is more costly. Now, I think a lot of people don't know about this point. They think that you just buy an inflatable vest and then it lasts you for the rest of your life. A lot of the people that buy foam vests think that too. Foam vests have a lifespan of 5 years. That's mostly the nitrile PVC foams, and they disintegrate and break down with time and the elements and stuff like that. If you watch my other body protector videos, I go through all those details and you can look it up yourself. But 5 years, okay, for most, I would say 90% of the foam vests out there is 5 years. The Cantec vest is different in that it doesn't use nitrile PVCs. It uses this Knox armor, and it uses closed and open cell technology, and it's oh my gosh, I can't even think of the name of the material right now. But anyways, that one doesn't break down with time and stuff, so that one lasts longer. But I don't have an official number to tell you as to how long it lasts for, so it's kind of a question mark up there. They say forever, but to me that's not a very scientific answer, so I don't like giving that answer out. But I dug, and that's the best answer that I can get so far. So inflatables. Now, when the inflatable technology is changing a lot, and so be careful. Right now, this is February 2018, so check the date, because some of the information might be outdated if you're watching this 6 months to a year from now. The inflatables, hit air changed a lot. And at the beginning, hit air had a lot of problems. They had it so that there was no protection between the canister, that hard metal canister, between the canister and the body. And one of their airbags was over the canister and laying right up against the body. So that person, when the deployed, then that canister went into the rib cage. Point two, they have a level one foam separating between the body and the vest. Now, in Hit Air's defense, the Hit Air vest came from the motorcycling industry, and motorcyclists typically, unless you're a squid, you at least wear a leather jacket, and the leather jacket would be underneath and would be that layer between. But then you have your equestrians that wear just a simple shirt and then have that, and then the canister's right up against and there's nothing between. But Hit Air has changed that design, and they now, I think they put the airbag at the bottom and then the canister on top of that. So that brings to another point. With inflatables, make sure you don't have any hard things, anything between you and that vest. When that vest deploys, it's going to be fast, it's going to be hard, and it's going to put a lot of pressure on you, and whatever you're carrying, could become a projectile into your body, because your body is all soft. Especially if the horse then lands on top of you. So nothing between you and the vest. And then be careful about what you wear over the vest, because when the vest deploys, it's going to pump, poo like that. So if you wear something tight over it, it may interfere with the deployment of the vest, or it may damage whatever the outer thing is. It might tear your outer shirt or stuff. But if your outer shirt is really strong, then it may, something bad may happen. So give it room to deploy. You know that it's got to deploy. Okay, so then I'm going to talk about the difference between the two very popular brands out there for inflatable vests. It's going to be .2 versus Hit Air. Totally your personal preference, but I have found that there is data for big differences between the two. Okay, so .2. One, they're very transparent with all of their data. If you go to their website, they have tons and tons of safety information and stuff like that. Versus Hit Air, that it's not a lot of info. I mean, real data, not a lot of real data on there. I mean, just go and look for yourself, okay? And then with .2, I was able to message them on Facebook, and they contacted me right back immediately. The lady that contacted me back from their Facebook page was in the UK. And one thing I will say, the UK has a lot stricter standards for safety than the US. So .2 has UK office and US office as well, or offices. And the UK, if you speak with the UK people, they are going to be a lot more like me, you know, to try to, you know, gear you towards the top protection. But it's okay if you don't, because, you know, I mean, most important is whatever you're going to want to wear. But in the U.S., it's more like a lot more lax. It's like, hey, you're fine. Yeah, you know, it's fine. You know, they're more like that. And I don't like that for safety gear, just because I would rather they go, here is the most protection, and then you choose however way you go, rather than someone that goes, ah, you're fine. You know, yeah, there's a chance of this and this and this, but you'll probably never encounter it. You know, that sort of thing. So, okay, the .2 has a lifetime warranty on the airbag and trigger system if serviced annually. They make it a point to let their people know that they recommend that you service it annually after every 6 inflations or after any one particularly bad crash. Because an airbag, you know, the bag deploys if the bag may have some weak structural problems after the deployment, or I don't know, the seams may rip or something may happen. They want to check it. And oftentimes, if there's a question, it, you know, should I check it or not? You know, they will err on the side of caution, go, let us check it. So I love that about them. But the other thing to realize is that then now, if you only have one vest, you know, you now are out a vest until you get that back, right? You send it out to them, you know, and then you get it back. Now, the thing is, when they service it, they are able to separate the air bladder from the vest. They are able to check the entire thing and put it through the testing process again. And if they had made any upgrades to the vest since you last purchased it, they will add those upgrades to your vest for free. It's all covered in the $75 service charge or whatever it's going to be. And you get a vest that has been tested, you know, it's solid and upgraded and like new again. So that is an officer, that is an awesome service plan, and definitely worth looking into. They offer service plans, or you can go on a one-on-one basis. They do offer discounts, so check with them if you're part of some organization or something, you know, see about discounts. They also do have refurbished vests that are usually several hundred dollars cheaper than a brand new one, stuff like that. And I think that it's trustworthy to get the refurbished one, but I would ask them if the refurbished ones are covered in their, if they do have a lifetime warranty. I believe they do, but I'm not too sure, so definitely check on that. The .2 has one single airbag, so it's much quicker deployment and all this stuff, not like the Hit Air that has separate chambers, narrow passages to choke the CO2 dispersion, and the chambers can fold over on itself, like when you bend your body and stuff like that. So the .2's singular airbag makes it faster deployment. It's a 0.080 seconds deployment, and you know, all these other benefits. Okay, Now, the 0.2 may feel bulkier, heavier in hand because they do have more substantial materials, and often they do add a level one foam in with their inflatable vest just for extra protection and stuff like that, where they think they're critically needed. But that if you hold a 0.2 and a hit air vest side by side, you probably will see or feel that the hit air is going to be lighter area and stuff like that. You can interpret that as, oh, this is lighter area, more comfortable, or you can go, eh, this isn't a lot of protection. So depends on where you come from, but those are different ways to interpret that data. According to hit air's comparison chart, and this is going to be dependent on model, obviously, the 0.2 is 38.60 ounces versus hit air's 34.30 ounces. So that's only about a 4 ounce difference. Not that big a deal as far as weight is concerned. 0.2 does offer a Grow With Us program. So if you have a child that needs an air vest, they have a Grow With Us program where you can, as a child is growing, the vest will grow with them. They will change the size of the vest for a fee. And so, instead of having to buy brand new all the time. 0.2, last time I checked, their data said takes 84 pounds of pressure to pull the pin. They also offer several different products, so you can pick the one that best suits your style. They have hybrid vests where they combine foam and inflatable into one. The only thing, the only concern I have with that is the foam vest that they chose to team up with is race safe. Race safe, it does use a nitrile PVC type foam, so that foam vest does expire in 5 years, but your 0.2 vest doesn't, because if you get the annual servicing. So that hybrid is going to be no good for the 5 years because you can't separate the two. So in that case, in the long run, I think it would be better to just get the separate ones. The 0.2 lifetime warranty. You're never going to have to buy another one, just as long as you stay on top of the servicing, and you just wear that over whatever foam vest you choose, or not. They are fully certified, the Satra M38 beta level 3. They are very big on certification and safety, and they are more than willing to give you all that data on their safety and all that. They also had some cooperation with a spinal surgeon for the first 3 years of research, so that they could design the best possible vest. Now, Hit Air is very popular, but I think, one, it's because they're cheaper up front. They were cheaper up front, but they also, at the beginning, just had in very fine print say you have to replace it every 2 years. There was no service plan with their vests, so they just said replace it every 2 years. That right there makes it so that they're not the cheaper option in the long run. They did not offer any kind of service plan, so you had to replace it, and that also meant that because they didn't have a service plan, if you got into a crash or something, they weren't going to check it and make sure that it's all good to go. They're going to just go, yeah, just keep on wearing it, up to the 2 years, you're going to be fine. So for that. Now they offer a service plan, or they don't offer a service, they offer servicing, but you gotta check with them and really really ask. This is the important thing to ask. Ask them what their service plan entails, or their service entails, because unlike the 0.2, they cannot separate out the components of their vest. Therefore, they can't really service it. What they can do is deploy it, check it, look on the outside, stuff like that, stuff that you probably can do. There's a little bit more, but that's delving into some political stuff, and I don't want to go there. Just you check on your own. If you want to Hit Air, ask them, okay? They don't have a lot of data on their site, which I don't get. I get 0.2. they're proud of all of their safety information and they put it out there. If you ask them, they will give you more information than you even want to know, which is a lot coming from me to say that. HIT Air is very, you know, where is the data, right? I don't see any certifications or anything like that. So ask them about that. Are they certified? Have, you know, what kind of tests? What are the numbers? You know, the actual impact test data, all of that information should be available to us. They use the multiple air chambers. Their inflation time used to be a quarter of a second, 0.25, versus 0.2, which is 0.080. Okay, so that's a huge difference in time. They say four times faster inflation for the 0.2. But HIT Air does have newer models now, and their newest model is 0.09 second inflation time. So, you know, they're getting up there. The last time I checked, it's 66 pounds of pressure to pull the pin. They do have a bigger, you know, you can tell the difference between the HIT Air and the 0.2 because they have a bigger airbag right here on the neck. A lot of people like that because they go, okay, yeah, it's going to protect against this whiplash injury sort of thing, which I don't know if horses really give you whiplash. But okay, I don't know. But anyways, no, it's good to have as much protection around the neck and head. But look at the back right underneath. Right underneath there is, it's a hinge. That hinge gives you this vulnerable point where there is no airbag right up in there, right up in the neck area. So, you know, 0.2 says that is a big deal because their spinal surgeon said that's one of the weakest areas of the spine, is right there at the top of the spine and then the lower spine. So you don't want to have a weak point and hinge over there. But personal preference and stuff. They had major issues with earlier models, but now they seem to have fixed that. And they used to have it so there was no bleed valve, but they fixed that as well. They now do have compulsory bleed valves on there, and that is required as a safety thing. They have a 1-year limited warranty on defects and no accident replacement. That's HIT Air themselves. So 1-year warranty versus a lifetime warranty, okay? And then, but you can find places like Pedco, which is a HIT Air distributor. They have a replacement plan available, and you know, you can get all the details from them. And they cover 3 years, and it depends on what year it is and what model. They will cover 20 to 50% off of your purchase of a new vest. Okay, so I had written this whole thing up and then I posted it on Facebook, and then I figured I'd make this video so that because Facebook posts tend to get lost and disappear. So here's a video with all the data, and in the YouTube description and the comments, I'm going to go ahead and throw all of this other data onto there so that there's a written thing of it as well for you, okay? But bottom line, when it comes to safety, what should you get? If you are looking at what is the safest option, that is kind of easy to measure and give you real numbers. You can, that is objective data because they test it and you can see, you know, which ones absorb or deflect more shock impact force than others. That is objective data, okay? That is easy to figure out. The hard thing to figure out is which is the right protection for you, because what is, you know, right for me isn't going to be the right one for you. If you are like, okay, I need the lightest, you know, coolest option possible, or I'm not wearing anything at all, then I would say an inflatable. If you want the most uttermost protection in the whole wide world, you don't care about cost or heat or anything like that, a foam plus inflatable. if you want something that is always there, no matter if you're riding or not riding, you don't want to have to worry about if it's, you know, going to be there and throughout the entire length of your accident and all that stuff, then a foam vest that is always, even a foam vest that is expired and old and whatever, it's still a physical something that is there between you and the impact, okay? Even if it's lost its superpower absorbency, it still is a physical barrier. The hit air and the point to where any inflatable vest is not much of a physical barrier when it's not deployed. So hopefully that makes it a little clearer, so it makes it a little bit easier for you to choose whatever safety equipment you would like to wear for yourself. If there are any questions, you know, you can find me on Facebook and stuff like that and let me know. Otherwise, all this data is out there. I don't work for the companies or anything like that. In fact, neither one of them know that I exist, and that's probably better that way, because I think I kind of was speaking very critically for both of them or whatever, but I always give the goods and the bads and stuff like that, and I never try to push for any which way, because it's just whatever you're going to wear. You know, if you know the best protection out there, if it's uncomfortable and you hate it for whatever reason, you know, you don't wear it, it's not going to be able to protect you. So it's whatever you want to wear, you know, even if it's just a leather jacket or I don't know, whatever. Even if you want to cover yourself with cardboard and bubble wrap, you know, that's still going to be better than nothing. So there you go. Any questions, let me know. Otherwise, thanks for watching, and I'll talk to you later. Bye.